Next speaker is Lorenzo Mascotto from University of Vienne. So the talk is enriching virtual elements with singular functions.
Yes. So, okay, thank you very much for the introduction and for the invitation. Let me maybe also mention that I admire the endurance of the three organizers who keep the video on all the time, okay? So which is kind of admirable because, I mean, I can see the pain in the eyes. No, it's a joke, but I know that it's a bit hard, but okay. Okay, so today I'm going to talk about non-conforming virtual elements, okay? So which is a kind of standard technology. Yesterday, Daniele Prada, Franco Brezzi talked about that with some kind of twist on that. So I want to enrich them with some singular functions. Okay, let's try to see what I mean with that. But before that, let me mention that this is a joint work with the formidable Eduardo Artioli, who took care of the implementation details of that. And you can find also the preprint of this, what I'm going to talk about on archive, or you can just look on Google like Mascotto and you will find that. Okay, so I will start with a fairy tale. Okay, so once upon a time, there was an elliptic PD with some smooth data, some smooth boundary condition on a smooth domain. Okay, so you can imagine to have, say, a Poisson problem with right-hand side F, smooth, boundary condition G, smooth, let's say on a ball. Then I know that from standard regularity of elliptic PDEs, the solution to this problem is actually smooth. Good. One very sad day, the domain omega became Lipschitz. And now I'm interested to see what happens to our poor guy. So imagine that you have the ball and the ball becomes a square. I take exactly the same problem that I had before, smooth F, piecewise smooth G. Actually, now I'm very sad because the solution is not anymore smooth. And actually, you also know how the, let's say, the non-smoothness behaves. Notably, okay, just focus, for instance, on a square domain. Then I know from, again, this is kind of standard theory that the solution can be split into two contributions. So one, which is called U of A, which stands for U analytic or U smooth, plus a double, so let's say a sum on the vertices of a series of diabolical functions that I call S of L, okay, written for instance in polar coordinates at the vertex J, so RJ theta J, and these functions are actually singular. And for instance, in the case of Poisson, you know that these functions, depending on the size of the angle, are like this. So you have a singular radial component, R to some power, times a smooth angular part, okay? In principle, you actually also know how singular the functions are, and you discover that the strength of the singularity depends on the size of the angle and on the types of boundary conditions that you have. You also know, very important, because this will play a crucial role later, they belong to the kernel of the operator under consideration, and you also know the Sobolev regularity, which is typically finite. As a very small remark, I mean, I will focus on, in this talk, to the Poisson problem, similar results. So the compositions are valid for, let's say, elasticity, diffusion problem with piecewise constant coefficients. So the ultimate goal is to study maybe crack propagation with singularities at tip, okay? Now, as an example, I mean, the boss of the level, so who is the boss of the level on the L-shaped domain? I mean, the strongest singularity is given, this should be known, by R to the 2/3 times sine of 2/3 theta, which is not even H2. We can play even harder, so we can take a slit domain, Dirichlet boundary conditions, in this case, R to the 1/2, which is not even H3/2. And I can play even harder, so I can pick Dirichlet Neumann boundary conditions and then R to the 1/4, okay? Which is not even H^5/4, yeah? So this is a very nasty singularity. And if you do, let's say, I call it the wrongdoing, of course it's not the wrongdoing, but I mean, if I just run an H version of the method, so let's say that I do like mesh refinements, or I do even a P version, which means I keep the mesh fixed and then increase the polynomial degree, what I get is a very crappy convergence rate, in the sense that for the last examples that I was providing, the rate of convergence goes like H^1/4, which is very slow. So who are the page boys? So who can help us in this adventure? So adaptivity, as Marco Verani was saying this morning, HP methods, as probably Paul Houston will talk about tomorrow, or we can do some sort of enrichment, and this is what I'm going to do. which is kind of related to extended finite elements alla babushka, extended finite elements alla Belichko, Mue, Dolbo, or generalized finite elements alla babushka, but with a different twist. So in that case, you want to have conforming methods, you want to use partition of unity. I don't want to use that. And so if you want, I mean, the core idea, the main idea that you have to take from my talk is that I take a standard skeletal method, non-conforming VEM, HDG, HHO, whatever you want, and you dope it with singular functions, okay? But okay, we'll focus, I mean, on non-conforming VEM for simplicity. And I repeat, HHO, HDG can be employed as well. There is a very recent preprint, like 1 week ago, by a PhD student in Melbourne who published, at least he submitted a work on HHO with enrichment based on our approach. And if you want, okay, the epilogue of the fairy tale, which is the outline of my talk, is the following. So we'll talk about spaces, so how to design a space which is enriched with these nasty functions. I will talk about the method. I will not talk about the analysis because okay, maybe it's a bit tedious, people are completely destroyed and so on. I will show some numerical results. And then I will also say, I mean, this is a, you know, a bit propaganda. Maybe it's not fully true what I'm going to say, but why skeletal methods rule in this setting, okay? I will also make a main assumption for the sake of simplicity. I assume that I only have one singular function at one vertex. Of course, what I'm going to present can be extended to more general situations, but just for the sake of presentation, let's stick to this. So my U is going to be the sum of a singular function and an analytic function. Okay, so what kind of meshes? This is a polygonal workshop. I can use this mesh, Voronoi, hexagons, but I can also use these kind of weirder elements, and they utterly work fine at the numerical level. So I can use, like this is an heptagon. I have 7 vertices where 2 vertices are collapsed and 2 edges that are collapsed. I can even use elements of this sort. So hexagons, you know, with an internal cut, and the method, at least from the practical point of view, then of course one may argue about the theory, but at least from the practical point of view, the method works and we have numerics with these elements. A little of notation, I'm very sorry for this. Try to it's just 2 lines. So I just want to introduce P tilde L of K. So L is a natural number and P tilde L of K is the direct sum of standard polynomials plus my singular function, okay? Whatever the shape of this function is. And then I also define another space tilde. So tilde means enriched, which is given by standard polynomials on an edge of the element K, direct sum with the Neumann trace on the edge of the singular function, okay? And then I can define my non-conforming enriched virtual element spaces. But I want to be gentle, and then I recall briefly how the standard non-conforming VEM looks like. So it consists, I mean, the local spaces consist of functions that solve a local Poisson-Neumann problem with polynomial right-hand side of degree P-2 and with Neumann boundary condition of degree P-1, okay? And the degrees of freedom are moments. So I have bulk moments of this sort and edge moments. This is standard non-conforming, no novelty. Old papers, Manzini, Ayuso, and so on, Lipnikov. For P equal to 1, I just have 1 degree of freedom per edge. I fix constant Neumann boundary conditions on each edge, 0 Laplacian. P2, I had 2 boundary degrees of freedom and 1 internal degree of freedom. P equal to 3, I have 3 per edge plus 3 in the interior. Now I want to do the twist. I want to insert somehow singular functions inside. And the twist is highlighted in red and actually in green in the figure. So I'm not doping the Laplacian, I'm simply doping the Neumann boundary condition. So I ask that the Neumann boundary condition now is a piecewise enriched polynomial on each edge. So I need, of course, to pump up the set of degrees of freedom on the boundary, and it will be kind of similar to the boundary degrees of freedom, which means that I need to fix a moment of an enriched function, okay, the Neumann trace. And the nice thing is that, I mean, if you just look for P equal to 1, 2, and 3, the degrees of freedom are exactly the same as standard non-conforming VEM plus 1 degree of freedom per edge, okay? So I'm not going to talk about implementation, but the nice feature of this method that I'm presenting is also that if you take a non-conforming VEM code, you just need to add 1 line, if you have 1 singular function, to each matrix, okay? So it's a kind of simple modification of the available codes. Okay, so this is my space. Why is this space very nice? Well, because I know, I've already said before, that the singular function has zero Laplacian, okay? So what I'm saying is that the enriched polynomial space of degree at most p, which means standard polynomials of degree p, plus a singular function is actually contained in this space. Why? Well, because I mean, I go back, the Laplacian is still a standard polynomial, and I pumped up, in a clever way, the boundary degrees of freedom, okay? How do I construct the global space? I'm not going to spend words on that. It's standard non-conforming matching. And of course, I mean, okay, now there is the story, I want to have stabilizations, I want to have projections, so there is nothing surprising here. The only little difference that I have is that if I want to compute a projection in the consistency part, of course, if I want to retain some extra approximation properties of the polynomial discontinuous space, I want to project onto enriched polynomials. So you see that the projection takes a function in the virtual element space and it maps it into the enriched polynomial space. The definition is through H1 projection, so it's the standard one. Is it computable? Well, I mean, we can check. I mean, I just do an integration by parts. I have a Laplacian of an enriched polynomial, which is standard polynomial, and then this, I mean, you can take into account this term using standard degrees of freedom, and then I have the boundary term that can be dealt with using the boundary degrees of freedom. So you didn't understand, no worry, you can compute a projection onto enriched polynomials. And then I have the discrete bilinear form, which is, as usual, no surprise, sum of local contributions. Each local contribution is the sum of a consistency term and a stability term. The only extra twist is that the projection is not onto standard polynomials. And the stabilization needs to satisfy lower and upper bounds of coercivity and continuity. Surprises on the design of the method? No, absolutely not. Yeah, the projection involved in the approximation of the right-hand side is a standard projection, no enrichment here. So the only modification is the design of this bilinear form, okay? So I promised that there was no theory, so I'm just presenting the final result if you want. So if you take a standard H version of any method, say non-conforming, virtual elements, finite elements, whatever, I already said that the convergence is extremely slow if the solution has not a high Sobolev regularity. So it typically goes as the minimum between the polynomial degree and K, where K is, let's say, the regularity, Sobolev regularity minus one. Enriched H version, what happens? I basically drop the dependence in the convergence with respect to the Sobolev regularity, which means that I can achieve a higher order convergence. And one can expect, I mean, we don't have the analysis, but one can expect that the P version works as well with exponential convergence. Okay, so now we pass to the final part of the talk with some numerical experiments. Just to make it clear, so far I was assuming that I described the construction of a single element where enriched took place. Of course, I can enrich all the elements. So all polygons have the singular function, or I can do some intermediate way. So I can enrich three elements, let's say the elements touching the singularity. I take standard elements outside, so outer, so in outer layers, and then have some intermediate layers. I can also do the same for, let's say, a domain with internal collection. This, I will present three test cases. So one is on the L-shaped domain, and I have a singular function, the Diebold guy, and plus an analytic function. I take a slit domain, so you remember the square with a cut, and I take the so-called enriched patch test, which means I take just a singular function, and in principle, if I enrich all the elements, I expect the error to be zero up to conditioning. So testing the method on this is a good indicator on the quality of the method, and then I will do the same for the L-shaped domain. Okay, let's start. Standard non-conforming VEM goes as expected. Algebraic convergence, I'm on an L-shaped domain, the smoothness of the function is less than h to the 5 divided by 3. So the rate of convergence cannot be better than 2/3. And this is what you observe, p1, 2, 3. Fair enough, expected. Okay, fully enriched non-conforming VEM. So I enrich all the elements. We look for p1, okay, and we're very happy. We recover linear convergence. I look p equal to 2, which is the blue line. We still recover convergence, quadratic. So we're already better than standard methods. But then I look at p equal to 3. So there is this diabolical behavior. There is a blow up. And then I remember, I mean, last year I was talking with Eduardo, say, Eduardo, come on, there is an error in the code for the IR. No, there was no error in the code. And I will explain you why this is not working soon. Well, I can try to see what happens if I do not enrich all the elements. I just enrich one layer of elements and I see what happens with exactly the same test case. P1, P2 were working properly, now they still work properly. And P3, it works. We're very happy. Just enriching fewer elements. Okay, let's look at an H version for a patch test. This is not very nice because, I mean, I'm just, this is, again, a patch test. So the error should be zero up to machine precision. Then I look for P=3, after three refinements, I get an error of 10^-4. This is very bad. Okay, I'm still not very happy. And especially since originally I was born as an HP guy or a P guy, I mean, I tried to run a P version, I expect exponential convergence, and I cannot observe that. I mean, I observe algebraic convergence for standard methods, the magenta line. I still observe, algebraic convergence, which is not nice because I expected to have exponential convergence, but at least it's better in the constant. And then there is this horrible behavior here. So the error is like 10^4 after a few P refinements. So who is the culprit? We have to find the culprit, the scapegoat for this. And the scapegoat is that this, if you look closely to how the singular function looks like and how a constant function, which is inside my space, look like, if I'm close to the singularity, so I'm just taking the radial component, the constant function, which is this tiny blue line, and the singular function, they look similar, but they're still a bit different. But if I move far from the singularity, so here it was like at 0.01, here I'm at 1, the two functions are the same almost. So there is linear dependence. So I need a therapy for this. I need to orthonormalize the edge basis involving the singular functions. And this is what I do, actually what Eduardo did. And let's see on the patch test what happens. I mean, on the patch test, you see an incredible improvement for the H version. Let's say you have like 10 orders improvement. So, I mean, now the method that we offer is reliable at least. And the P version, something similar. I mean, you have like, 10 orders of improvement. And as a very last slide, last but one slide, I recovered the holy grail, you know, the P for the P version of the method exponential convergence with the orthonormalized version. And as a very last, okay, this is propaganda, as I said. So the orthonormalization is very local in our settings. So in HHO, in HDG, non-conforming them, you can really orthonormalize at the phase level and at the bulk level. And in a way, there is no, what I call no extra pollution, in the sense that if you try to do a partition of unity approach, which means you have like singular functions in all elements, and you try to glue them together with a partition of unity, and you try to orthonormalize, you basically lose the locality of your basis functions. So asymptotically, we'll have basis functions that are orthonormal or orthogonal, but that have the support on the whole domain. And now I know that some people will complain, but also in DG, if I orthonormalize in the bulk, I just have functions in the bulk and I orthonormalize them, who guarantees me that when I consider on the interfaces, the interaction between basis function into neighboring elements, that they behave properly? ? This is propaganda, I repeat. And I thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you, Lorenzo. I have a question that was written on the chat from Jong Chen, he is a PhD student. And I read the question. Why the method is non-conforming, but your mesh are conforming? So maybe you have to explain.
Yes, so the non-conformity, in principle, you can also use non-conforming meshes. I mean, this method works regardless. By non-conformity, I mean the design of the global space. So, I mean, let me try to go back. I mean, there is nothing to, I mean, all the meshes are included as long, okay, we don't know for curvilinear meshes, but all meshes are fine. What I mean by non-conformity is that you don't enforce continuity across elements, but you enforce it in a kind of weak way. So you basically demand that the that the jump of functions on an interface is not zero strongly, but is zero when tested with all polynomials on the edge, or in our case enriched polynomials.
Okay, thank you.